Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, please, everybody have a seat. Everybody have a seat. Thank you so much. Well, first of all, let me say I am so sorry for being late. I have to admit that a lot of campaigns are late sometimes, but we have tried to stay on time. This morning, we just got all messed up. And so I am very sorry, but I appreciate all of you being so patient and taking the time to wait. I want everybody to please give Eileen and Bill Fonseca a huge round of applause. I told Eileen she was really good. She's a natural. We're going to have to run her for something. I want to thank John Fiddler, the principal of Great Valley High School. And all the students of Great Valley. I want to thank Kathy Cazone, Chester County Commissioner, who is here. Where's Kathy? Where'd she go? There she is right there. I'm proud to have her support. I haven't seen him, but if he's in the audience, one of my dearest friends, one of the greatest public servants in America, who was also a former senator from here in Pennsylvania, Harris Wofford. Is Harris here? Oh, there he is. Harris Wofford. Not only has Harris been a great supporter, not only was he a close confidant to President Kennedy, but Harris Wofford also is 82 years old today. It is his birthday, so give Harris a big round of applause. Thank you. Happy birthday, dear Harris. Happy birthday to you. We got some pretty good voices back there. There you go. Finally, I think a lot of you know that this is really a grassroots effort. You know, when we started this campaign, people were skeptical that we could pull this off, partly because we weren't taking money from PACs and lobbyists, and so people said, oh, they can't raise the money. We didn't have all the endorsements from the Washington insiders. They said, oh, he can't put his organization together. And we have done extraordinarily well because we've had grassroots support throughout this campaign. This has really been a people's campaign. And so for those of you who are interested in getting involved, if you're not already, I think people, we had these volunteer forms that you may have received coming in. We'd love for you to fill one out because we'd love for you to help us reach out to your neighbors and your friends and your family, make sure that they are turning out and participating in what I think is going to be the most important election in our lifetime. So I have been running for 15 months now, which means that there are babies who've been born and are now walking and talking since I announced that I was running for president. And when I started running, there were some people who said, Barack, why are you running this time? You're a relatively young man. Why are you running so soon? You can afford to wait. And I had to explain to them that I wasn't running because of some long-held ambition or because I thought it was my turn. I'm running because of what Dr. King called the fierce urgency of now. The fierce urgency of now. Because I believe there's such a thing as being too late. And I think that hour is almost upon us. We are at a defining moment in our history. Just yesterday, we were in Senate hearings talking to General Petraeus and Ambassador Crocker about the war in Iraq, a war that has now lasted longer than World War I, World War II, and the Civil War. A war that, even if we started withdrawing now, would cost us well over $1 trillion, $400 million a day that we are spending in Iraq, 4,000 plus have been killed, thousands more injured, and it's distracted us from the war that we still have to win, the war against Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan and Pakistan, those who killed 3,000 Americans. But it's not just the war that I think is weighing on people's minds today. Last week, I traveled throughout this great state of Pennsylvania, and I met folks in factories and in farms and in bars and the bowling alleys, I'm going to be practicing, guys. I just want you to know. High schools. But whether I was talking to apparel workers in Allentown or steel workers in Pittsburgh, I kept on seeing the same core values that Eileen was talking about in her introduction. People love the ideals of freedom and equality and opportunity enshrined in the founding documents that were written right here in Pennsylvania. Whoever our sound person is, for some reason I'm getting I'm hearing some other room somewhere. We've heard a couple of doors close and people are shuffling around. Just wanted to, whoever our sound folks are. But, it might be the principal calling me to the office. That's what I'm worried about. But, people love the ideals of freedom and equality and opportunity that were enshrined right here in Pennsylvania. People believe in opportunity. They believe in an honest day's work. People want a better life for their children and for their neighbors and for Americans. It's that spirit, that sense of shared values and common destiny that makes us one nation and that has lifted America into a prosperity that the world has never known before. But I also know that this spirit is all too often absent in our economy today because far too many working people are struggling to achieve the opportunity that should be America's birthright. Now, we all know that all the signs are pointing to recession. Our economy has lost 232,000 jobs since the year began, 80,000 last month alone. The cost of everything from health care to a gallon of milk to a gallon of gas to college tuition have gone up at the same time as wages have gone stagnant. We just completed the first economic expansion since World War II, since we started recording these statistics, where the average income of working families didn't go up, it actually went down. Went down by $1,000 when you adjust for inflation. Millions of Americans are facing foreclosure because of the housing crisis, and meanwhile, the government has bailed out a big investment bank after the pain of the credit crunch started to hit Wall Street, which just shows you that under the Bush administration, pain actually trickles up. Now, these troubling indicators only begin to tell a story that was written into communities across this state and across this country over the last 7.5 years. It's a story of empty factories that used to be the economic engine for entire towns shut down forever because the jobs have been shipped overseas and nothing took their place. It's a story told by mothers who can't sleep at night because the children are sick and they're not sure whether they can afford hospitalization or the health care that those children need. By fathers who can't find work and can't figure out how to pay a mortgage. It's the story that you see in the eyes of young people who have the talent and the drive to go to college, but just don't have the money that could help them live out their American dream. It's a story of the American dream slipping away. And I am running for President of the United States because that story of diminishing opportunity starts in Washington. It's not an accident. They're the consequences of a tired and cynical economic philosophy that has failed the American people. Because for over 2 decades, what we've heard from President Bush has been the so-called ownership society, which really means you're on your own. If you're a child who is born into poverty, pick yourself up by your bootstraps, you're on your own. If you're somebody who lost their job, but also their health care and their pension when the job got shipped overseas, tough luck, you're on your own. If you're a single mom trying to look after your kids, you're on your own. Let me be clear, the changes to our economy that began in the 1980s were in response to policies that did need to change. We had high taxes and we had outmoded regulations that needed to be reformed for a changing economy and changing times. But instead of responsible reform that rewarded success and freed the creative forces of the market, too often we've excused and even embraced an ethic of greed, corner cutting, and insider dealing that's distorted our economy. Far too many Republicans embraced this ethic, but Democrats have sometimes been too timid in confronting it as well, and too comfortable letting special interests rewrite the rules instead of setting rules of the road that protect working people. We let go of the past, but we never finished that bridge to the future of lasting prosperity, and instead we lost that common stake in each other's prosperity. So under George Bush, we've seen tax cut after tax cut going to the wealthiest Americans who don't need them and didn't even ask for them. We've been burdened with an overloaded tax code that's too complicated for ordinary people to understand, but just complicated enough for Washington lobbyists who know how to work the system. We favored wealth. We favored wealth over hard-working families like the Fonsecas, with $1 trillion in tax loopholes in the corporate tax code that have allowed companies to stash profits overseas and trade deals that have made it easier for companies to ship jobs overseas. And this philosophy has been neither compassionate nor conservative. And we've run up hundreds of million dollars in deficits and trillions of dollars in debt. And we've turned back on working people without health care and families who are losing their homes and retirees who've lost their pensions. Instead of a level playing field for all Americans, we've let special interests tilt the scales in Washington. And that's why income inequality in this country has been growing since 1981. That's why we have CEOs who make more in one day than their employees make in an entire year. That's why we've been subjected to cycles of bubble and burst, and that's why, even before this latest crisis, we had not seen incomes and wages go up for the typical American family. And that's why we've got a very clear choice in this election. Now, I respect John McCain. He'll be a worthy opponent. He is a genuine American hero. But if you believe that our economy is on the right path, then John McCain's the right candidate for you. Senator McCain has been a staunch supporter of Washington's failed policies. And in this election, he'll offer more of the same policies that have set back working people. I admired Senator McCain when he stood up and said that the Bush tax cuts for the wealthiest Americans offended his conscience. That's what he said. But he got over that. And now he's all for them. And for continuing to do the same things that have taken us towards recession. His solution to George Bush's fiscal mess is to make George Bush's tax cuts permanent. His solution to the struggles of working people is reflected in his answer to the housing crisis, which is to sit idly by and hope it passes as millions of people face foreclosure and millions more watch the values of their home erode. So I intend to offer a new direction. That's why I'm running for president. I believe we won't have a strong economy unless government acts responsibly and everybody has a fair shake. And that means we can't keep mortgaging our children's future on a mountain of debt. We can't keep driving a wider and wider gap between the few who are rich and the rest who are struggling to keep pace. We can't keep allowing special interest lobbyists to rig the system for their own benefit. We can't keep embracing the idea that somehow Wall Street can thrive while Main Street crumbles. It is time to turn the page. It is time to try something new. It is time to write a new chapter in American history. It's time to end the Bush-Cheney-McCain policy that tells Americans you're on your own, because we're all in this together as Americans. We believe. We believe in the fundamental ideal that has always been at the heart of this nation's progress, that I am my brother's keeper, I am my sister's keeper, that we have a stake in each other's prosperity. And we know that government can't solve all our problems. We don't want it to. We don't expect it to. We want our tax dollars spent wisely. We don't want them wasted on pork barrel projects or perks for special interests that don't work for us. We understand that we can't stop every job from going overseas. We understand that we're in a competitive economy, and each of us has a responsibility to work hard and get educated and to continually retrain. But that's not an excuse to spend another 4 years seeing our government do nothing to reclaim the American dream. We are a nation. We are a nation that built the largest middle class in history. We are a nation that has always believed in the American dream, not Joe's dream, not Sally's dream, but the American dream. That's why we call it the American dream, because we have a stake in seeing other people achieve the dream, not just ourselves. We don't just look out for ourselves. That's why throughout this campaign I've put forward a series of proposals that can help grow the economy from the bottom up and not just from the top down. That starts with a stimulus that will reach most Americans, including the most vulnerable. Immediate relief for those hardest hit by the housing crisis. A significant extension of unemployment insurance for those who are out of work. If we can extend a hand to banks on Wall Street who are having trouble and who are struggling, then we certainly can do the same for individuals who are having a tough time and who are struggling. But beyond the short term, we have to put the American dream on a firmer footing. To reward work and make retirement more secure, we're going to roll back some of the Bush tax on the wealthiest Americans and give tax breaks to those who really need them, people making $75,000 or less. We're going to cut taxes. We're going to cut taxes to offset the payroll tax so that people are saving as much as $1,000 per family per year, helping to offset the rising costs of gas. Senior citizens who are making $50,000 a year or less, they shouldn't have to pay income tax on their Social Security because they're already straining under fixed incomes. To make health care more affordable, I'm going to work with employers to lower premiums by as much as $2,500 per family per year. And if you don't have health care, you're going to be able to buy into a plan that is at least as good as the health care I have as a member of Congress. You pay my salaries. I shouldn't have better health care than you have. And we're not going to wait 20 years from now to do it, or 10 years. We're going to do it by the end of my first term as President of the United States of America. We want to invest in infrastructure, rebuilding our roads and our bridges, putting people back to work, and putting our economy on a track for greater competitiveness. We also want to invest in green technology, the jobs of the future. You know, we're spending $1 billion a day because of our addiction to foreign oil. And instead, what we should be doing is capping the emission of greenhouse gases that are causing global warming. We can generate billions of dollars that we reinvest in solar and wind and biodiesel, putting people back to work, building windmills, building solar panels, making buildings more energy efficient. That's our future. And part of our future has to be to rebuild our education system. I want every child to have the best education this country has to offer, from the day that child is born to the day that child graduates from college. So, so We're gonna invest in early childhood education to close the achievement gap and make sure every child's prepared when they start school. And I won't just talk about how great teachers are. I will reward them for their greatness. We're going to pay our teachers more money. We're going to give them more support. I want the highest standards for our students because, young people, you're going to be competing against young people in China and India. And we're going to have to work harder and we're going to have to work smarter. But I don't want those standards measured just by a single high-stake standardized test, because we want our kids learning art and music and science and civics. We don't want teachers teaching to the test. We want a well-rounded education. And I think it's about time we made college affordable. I don't know about you. So we're going to provide a $4,000 tuition credit every student every year so that you're not loaded up with $30,000, $40,000, $50,000 worth of debt, but you're going to have to give something back in return. You're going to have to participate in community service, work in a homeless shelter, work in a veteran's home, join the Peace Corps. We'll invest in you. You invest in America. Together we can march this country forward. I know that we can make these changes. I know because the American people have told me over the last 15 months that they are ready for change. They have said that they are ready, and if the American people are ready, then we can go ahead and tell the special interests in Washington their days of setting the agenda are over. They have not funded my campaign. They will not run my White House. They will not drown out the voices of the American people when I'm President of the United States. And if you will stand with me in this election, if you will organize with me and mobilize and speak out on behalf of a fair and more just and more equal America, I promise you we will not just win Pennsylvania, we will win this nomination, we will win the general election, and you and I together will change the country and change the world. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.